The chapel here where we are today is a very historic place as it relates to the civil rights movement. Any of the quote unquote leaders of the civil rights movement that you can name, I would say, has been here and spoke from where I am, all from up there. This actually was a haven for us in the civil rights movement. If you were a student in the public schools or universities and got involved in the civil rights movement in Mississippi, you got sent home. You could not do that. That was not permissible. So many of, some of the students who was real interested in actively getting involved, two such people were the sisters Joyce and Dory Latin. They came straight out of Jackson State to Tougaloo so they could continue their education and work in the civil rights movement at the same time. The Klan had focused on Tougaloo where they had intended to burn down, destroy in certain ways, but some of us students decided that we could not let that happen. And we formed a security team. Faculty and administration knew we had a security team, but you know, guns and all that kind of stuff not allowed on the college campus. So we didn't tell them that we had all that good stuff to make sure that Tougaloo remained safe. However, it's still here, and we're thankful for that. So I don't know what all kinds of questions are, what all kinds of things that y'all want to hear from me. So what I'm going to do is just tell you a little bit about myself and open it up for you to ask me questions, because I can stand here and talk about these 50-something years, a part of my life, and 70-something years of another part of my life, and you may not want to hear anything about it. So I'm going to just give you a little bit about my background and experience. I am the youngest of 12 children. My parents were sharecroppers. I got my first real job when I was 4 years old. I became the water boy for my family. I had to get the water and bring it to the field for my parents and older brothers and sisters to have something to drink. So I had to walk almost a quarter of a mile one way delivering that water. So you know, it wasn't such an easy job, but that was my job. Growing up as a young black man, we were taught that if you were coming down the sidewalk and you were meeting a white man, you had to step off the side and bow your head until he passed. Once he passed, you got back on and went where you were going. And if you met a white woman, you definitely had to do that because a white woman might report you as having looked her in the face. Looking a white woman in the face at that time was considered a very, very important aspect of life. You should not do because it was considered the term to call eyeball rape if you look the white woman in the face. Now, it doesn't take much to eyeball rape someone, because see, I've eyeball raped all of the women in here since I first mentioned eyeball rape. So you definitely had to step on the side. I had to walk to school with my older brothers and sisters. If we went around the road, it was almost 3 miles one way. And if you went through the woods, it was about a mile and a half. So most of the time, we would figure out how to go through the woods to go to the little school. So there is a group of people that we don't give enough credit to, which actually began, especially in Mississippi, began and laid the foundation for our modern civil rights movement. Anybody have any idea what that group of people, or who that group of people might have been?
Teachers.
Ma'am?
Teachers.
No, ma'am.
Churches?
No.
Churches?
No.
Artists?
Quakers?
No.
Artists?
No.
Musicians?
No. The group of people, pardon?
Students.
Students.
Ah! It was more young people involved in the civil rights movement once it got started. But the group I'm talking about was World War II veterans. World War II veterans. Those brothers, they went overseas and they fought in different countries. And when they came back, they realized that they had been over there fighting for people in other countries to have the right to do things that they themselves did not have the right to do. So they decided that they were going to begin to do something about that. And that's what gave rise to our modern, as we say, civil rights movement. World War II veterans. I first got involved in the civil rights movement when I was, by the way, anything about my history, you won't answer that question. I first got involved in the civil rights movement at the age of 17. I got involved as a result of going to a meeting Medgar Evers had with young people. And that's where I first got involved, 17. In 1961, 2 years later, I got involved with the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, better known as SNCC. While working with SNCC, you know, I had some close calls, as we say. Came close to losing my life. But I grew up, as some folks say, as a very spiritual, religious person. And I believe in God. And I believe, based on some things that I saw and heard, experienced, that God revealed to me that I would never be killed in the civil rights movement. So I had no problem in being active in the civil rights movement. And the flip side of that came with the military. I thought he revealed to me that if I got in the military, I'd never make it out alive. I didn't go to the military. That's a whole nother long story. The battle, what I went through and did as a part of that. But I guess very early on, because I was first one of SNCC people to have a sit-in at the Woolworths lunch counter here in Mississippi. Got put in jail, ultimately spent 34 days in jail for trying to order a cup of coffee. But I guess God tested my faith, because after having been arrested, the police did not take me back to my cell. He took me to a little room upstairs in the courthouse. And he just pulled the door together, never said nothing. So I sat in a chair. In a few minutes, three white men came in the room. When they walked through the door, I looked. And they had a rope in their hand. The rope had a hanging noose in it, with a little red ribbon tied just beneath that noose. And they looked at me, and they said, "Okay, niggas, so get up and let's go. So we're gonna have a hanging here, and your black, blank, blank, blank is gonna be first." So here I am facing a rope with a hanging noose tied in it, and three white men who looked as if they had just gotten off of work from an oil field. So God proved to me that he was with me, because he instilled some things in my mind that I probably never would have figured out how to do. And that thought that came to my mind was, how am I going to kill these three white men right here on the spot? And I looked them dead in the eye as I'm thinking that. And they turned and went back. While in jail, there are many different times when you have to be careful, tricks and traps will be set up for you. Several of those were set up for me, and I will mention a couple of those traps. The first one had to do with a trap that involved a white woman. And she came in, they put her in the hallway in front of ourselves, and she came in walking somewhere like this here and cursing the police out for everything I think she could think of, and telling me how they had beat her all on her clothes and everything. And she wanted to show me so I could help bear witness and testify on her behalf. So she came to the front of my cell and propped her foot up on the cell, and I ran to the back of my cell. And when that happened, the police called her and told her, "Come on out." When they called and told her to come on out, she went out like this. So they said to me that that was a trap, because what was supposed to happen is that I was supposed to have come up to the front of my cell to observe where she supposedly had been beaten. And see, all she had to do when I came to observe, reach through the bar, grab the instrument. Had she done that, I would have been charged with attempting to rape a white woman while in jail. One of the other little tricks that they tried to pull on me had to do with the jailer coming and getting me and telling me, "Come go with me." And I saw he was going out of the building. And when he got to the little porch step thing in front of the building, he told me, he says, "Hollis, since you have been a good nigga," it's just how he said it, "since you've been a good nigga, have not caused us any problem, we gonna let you go." So I asked him, I says, "Who put up my bond?" He says, "Nobody. We just gonna let you go since you've been such a good nigga." So I told him, I said, "Well, the system don't work like that." You know, I say, "I know I have not served my time, and if you haven't put up your bond, then you can't get out. So I'm gonna go back in the cell." And when I turned around and started back, he told me, he said, hold it, right there. Don't make another step, so I'll blow your brains out. So I stopped, I'm standing there. And he told me, he pointed his finger, he said, you better be glad you didn't walk down them steps, said, because if you had walked down them steps, I was gonna whistle. And when I whistled, them boys was gonna bring them dogs out. And he whistled. And sure enough, when he whistled, two black men came from around the side of the building with bloodhound dogs. And he said, them dogs are gonna have dinner in your backside. So you know how sometimes we are young folks, we look smart and we have to get the last thing. So I told him, I said, I ain't scared of no dogs, so my daddy taught me how to kill them. But you know, we have to do certain things sometimes to get off a little frustration. But that's what I did. The thing that actually came to my mind, which I had heard of, being here from Mississippi, that they had done that with different black people. And when they got out in the yard, they shot them in the back and reported that they were attempting to escape. They hollered for them to stop, but they wouldn't stop, so they had no other choice but to shoot them in the back. So that was a little thing that I escaped again, you know, because that was a trap that was set up for me that was supposed to take me in. Many nights, many days, I was chased by white men with guns in the cars, and knowing that if they had caught us, they were gonna kill us. Mississippi had a terrible record back then. This was back during the time in the early 60s, I'm talking about, where we had a state representative by the name of Eugene Hurst came up to a black man whom he knew that had attempted to register to vote by the name of Herbert Lee, killed him in cold blood right there at a cotton gin. And the atmosphere, the people were so afraid. Nobody would come forward and testify that they saw Eugene Hurst kill Herbert Lee. Eventually, another black man named Lewis Allen came forward, testified that he saw exactly what happened, described how Eugene Hurst had killed Herbert Lee. In a short period of time, as he was going into his property, he was shot one night. And that was the end of it. But the whole thing about chasing, it causes me today to say one of the major things that I am thankful for, is dirt roads. Dirt roads.
What?
What?
Dirt roads. Yes, it was the dirt roads that saved our lives many times. You're being chased. You're going down the dirt road. Your vehicle is kicking up dust. And the dust creates a buffer between you and the people that's chasing you to kill you. And because of that buffer, they never can get close enough to kill you. So I'm thankful for the dirt roads. So I'm talking about these little bitty things. It's a lot of times we overlook and forget about the little things that meant so much. One other little thing that I'm thankful for is that at that time, we didn't have push-button windows on our vehicle. Now, you know, I'm thankful that we didn't have those back then. And the reason for that is because white man in a truck start chasing me. I pushed my little pedal all the way down to the floor, but I couldn't get no distance on this man that's chasing me. And finally, he pulled along beside me, you know, and the first mind says, make a weave and hit him and knock him off. And then it says, you know, that's crazy because this little car can't stand up nothing to the truck that this man is in. So you just kill yourself. So I didn't try that. The man reached over into the glove compartment of his truck and he came out with a pistol, one of them long 38s, that's what they used to call it. And he did this. So I got a little scared, you know, heart got to beating fast. And then all ease came when he says, his window is not. He's not gonna shoot through his window of his truck just to shoot you. You know, and I relaxed and he stayed there doing this for a while and then eventually passed on by. So that push button window, or not the lack of that push button window, saved my life. So there are a lot of things we went through, you know, just for trying to have the right that others had. And we had to suffer a little price. You know, I remember why working in the Delta area of Mississippi, in Greenwood, Mississippi, I was arrested for trying to get our folks registered to vote. And after being arrested, they sent me to the city jail, then to the county jail, then to the county penal farm. And the condition was so bad, because men were coming by with the guns pointed at us, the guard wouldn't attempt to do nothing. We just said, and look, but if you attempted to get some water without asking him, he put the gun on you and tell you to stop, declare what you're doing. So I went on a hunger strike and decided that I would not eat anything else while I was in there. I would go without food. Ultimately, I went 10 and a half days without eating any food, just drinking water. But they sent me from the county farm in LaFleur County to the Mississippi State Penitentiary. And see, that's where that verse come from. Remember the verse I said? What was it?
Parchment.
All right, but what did the verse say? If you don't believe that I've been to hell, follow me to the parchment jail. Now, what made it hell? The thing that made it hell had to do with how they treated us. Every day, they threatened to take us to the end of the row. See, they didn't put us in regular parchment jails. They put us in maximum security unit on death row. At the end of death row was the electric chair, at the other end of it was solitary confinement. Solitary confinement was a 6x6 concrete cell, 6 feet wide, 6 feet long. We had three men that were among us that were over 6 feet, so even if they had wanted to stretch out, they couldn't stretch completely out. Put 14 of us in at one time. It got so hot until sweat was running down the four corners of the wall. The entire wall got so wet until it was wet all the way from the ceiling until about 2 feet or so from the floor. It's a blessing that all of us didn't die from calling from outside Boise, but just said thank God we made it. So that's why, you know, I wanted to put that verse in there. And to me, we were living in hell. They put 14 of us in there at one time. 14 of a 6x6 concrete cell. The only place you could get air was a small crack underneath the front door. That's what we had to endure. They pulled me out a time or two and handcuffed me to the bars. They did that because if you sang or talked loud, they would punish you some kind of way. So a couple of times for my singing, they handcuffed me to the bars, you know, in this mess. They was positioned where you couldn't go down far enough to rest your feet by getting on your knees. So you just had to stay there, and if you had to go to the bathroom, you went. And when they came through, they saw what had happened, and they take you down and give you what you need for you to clean up after yourself and put you back up. So that's why, you know, when you look at those conditions, to me, that represented hell. And that's why I say, you don't believe that I've been to hell. Just follow me up there and look at those conditions and things that we went through. Singing was the thing that we used to really uplift our spirit, uplift the spirit of those that we were trying to get involved as a part of the process. I'm going to stop right there and take some questions, see if I can answer your questions, talk to you about things you want to hear about you. Just one, two.
Is there anything you would have done differently?
Pardon?
Is there anything you would have done differently?
Anything I would have done differently?
During the civil rights movement, and something you regret, maybe?
That I would have done differently had I known better is I would not have made a lot of the assumptions that I made. I made assumptions pertaining to who the leaders were in the community. And generally you looked at, you know, ministers or people that were head, served as presidents of different organizations. I would have done that different had I known better. But, you know, these are supposed to be the leaders. And I found out that I was looking at it the wrong way while I was in Greenwood. And how that came about was I'm going down the streets and little lady sitting on a porch rocking in a rocking chair. And she saw, I guess, that I was not from Greenwood. So she called me and said, "Come here, baby." "Yes, ma'am." Not the kind that I think we could have or should have. And one of the big problems is that we don't have places to have our meetings. And she says, "Why don't you have them at my church?" I said, "We can." She says, "Of course." She said, "You come back by here, baby, tomorrow, right afternoon, and I'll have you the keys to my church." I couldn't believe it, and I'm saying, I hope this old lady really pulling my leg and whatever. But I couldn't wait for 12 o'clock to come the next day. I'm watching my watch, And I walked down close to a house and sat on the side of the street and wait till those other 3 to 4 minutes passed, then I got up. And she saw me coming. She said, I see you. You made it back. And she started going down in a little bag, right by her rocking chair. And as I got real close, she did one of these numbers. So here you go. These are the keys to my church. Y'all have a good time. So that said to me that that same day when we first spoke to her, me and one of the other brothers had just got through meeting with the pastor and supposedly the stewardess or deacons from the church, and they said unequivocally no. So that said to me that they were not, you know, the ones that was in charge, one of the ones that was in charge was this little old lady sitting over there. And we never had not one complaint or anything from anybody in that church after we got the keys and moved on in there. Yes. I think for the most part, I have. You know, I think what happened as a part of that process, and for the most part, I say that because I realize when you got a lot of animosity or evil or what have you in your heart for anybody about anything, you are holding yourself back. You are punishing yourself. But if you can let that go, then you get a whole different breath of fresh air. And in realizing that, you know, then I said I got to whatever it is that I have this way that's negative and what have you, I got to let that go. The other thing that I realized is kind of tied to that, if somebody can make you angry and frustrated, they are your rulers, they control you. Because being in a situation in communities and country the way we are, we get to know one another and we get to know some of the things that, as we say, make you tick. So if I can push a button to make you all frustrated and angry, I can control you. When I see you heading in a direction towards something that is good and positive, I'm gonna push that button. And then you fly all off, you know, and you lose control. And I don't want anybody controlling me. So for the most part, I'd say you're right. I've been blessed to be able to see that, to know that, to understand that, and for the most part, to do it.
It doesn't mean you forgot.
Right.
You know, some people relate that sometimes together.
Right. No, I'm not saying forget.
Are you doing anything
more
for active services?
You mean how much of it am I doing?
Every day.
Yes, ma'am. I'm doing that day by day. I'm very active in trying to get people to support a good and decent candidate that's going to be coming up, that's going to eventually become our mayor, you know. And part of what I'm doing is, the biggest part of the things that I'm doing has to do with community organizing. And I believe in the intergenerational model of doing that. The reason I believe in that is because when I look back at the civil rights movement, in the areas where the young people and the older people were working together in harmony more progress was made in those areas than in the areas where you just had young people or you just had older people. And then when you look at the reality of things, I don't know if anything that directly affects the older people don't either directly or indirectly affect the young people, and vice versa. And you got that situation, then it seems natural that you should put your heads together and work together on that. So I'm doing a lot of community organizing, and I believe in the intergenerational model of organizing where the young and the older people come together and develop the strategy, the vision, and the program of work that's gonna get them to where they really, really need to be.
Wait, so. can you flush that out? There's one thing that I'm seeing. I'm bridging a gap here. When he says organizing, I think what I've come to understand, like in Minnesota, they have several women's initiatives. My wife runs a women's economic securities initiative down here. Organizing down here was required for it to be successful. In Minnesota, it's largely legislative, and there's not much organizing going on. We've worked with some of the ladies at the U, or my wife has, and the notice is that, well, there wasn't a whole lot going on. When organizing happens down the South, it's indispensable because there wasn't as much resources or assets or, energy, I guess, backed by dollar bills. In Minnesota, there seemed to be plenty of women, educated women at the university working on, some advocacy work or some stuff, but there wasn't as much organizing. And when he says he's doing work currently, he's doing really complex work, and sometimes organizing gets dumbed down. And when you start talking about redistricting and the vital importance of redistricting, there's a big block, and most people don't understand how critical what happened in Mississippi was, and that it's more unique here than any other place in the country, where there's larger judicial representation by minorities, legislative representation by minorities than any other place in the country, largely because of their work. Can you flesh that out a little bit more?
Well, one of the things that we try to get people to understand is that there's a difference between organizing and mobilizing. And most of us just do a great deal at mobilizing. One of the things that we found out that kept a lot of people from actively participating, for example, in the redistricting, for those that may not know, redistricting is a process of redrawing the geographical political boundary lines that determines who can run for an office and who can vote for those that run. One of the things we did was that we showed the people and redefined for ourselves what an expert was. Because the whole thing is, you got to be an expert in this to be redistricting, an expert. And we said, look at it. What is an expert? All of us are experts, because an expert is only someone who knows a little bit more than you know about a particular subject. And there are certain subjects that all of us know and can find that we know more about this than you know about it. So you're an expert. So don't discard yourself. But here again, even though we created districts that had a majority black voting age population, we had to work with our people to get them to understand that and to actively participate in that. In Mississippi, for example, very hard to get good judges, because the hatred and everything is so deeply implanted right there, is because if you are a lawyer and you running against a judge, and if you don't win, your law practice is basically thrown out the window. Because when you come before that judge that you didn't win out, he says, oh man, this is the same guy that ran against me. Guilty. So all of that, you know, ties into the whole piece that we have to look at and think about. But here again, all mobilizing is easy when you know it and understand it. Organizing is easy when you know it and understand it. And I just want to say, in terms of organizing, there are basically three major steps that you go through. I'm going to give them to you. Investigate, educate, negotiate on two levels, internally and externally, and demonstrate. That's how we go through that. And we'll be successful if we master and don't try to bypass any of those. And we'll be successful.
Okay, you gotta say that again. Investigate, negotiate.
Investigate, educate. Investigate, educate, negotiate. Negotiate internally and externally, and the fourth is demonstrate.
Got that. Sounds good. Oh, I have two questions. I'd like you to talk a little bit about going to Holmes County in early on, and Amzi Moore and John Ball. And that whole, like, the beginning.
The beginning.
And then I have another question about we were just talking about the Mississippi Civil Rights Museum opening in December. Mm-hmm. And I just wondered if you had any dealings with them, or if they've contacted you or anything.
They've contacted me a lot of times. I think they got me on board now.
Okay.
To go speak to some folks about something for them. You know, I expected more out of my state than I should have, because they went through this whole elaborate process to determine where the museum is going to be built. After doing all of that, spending the money, doing all of that, and they finally decided that the best place would be out here at dear old Tougaloo.
Okay.
When they decided that, now the question is, who gonna raise the money? All the folks that raised lots of money for the site where it is now, they couldn't raise any for Tougaloo. So, put it there, and you know, that's heartbreaking to me, because this is my alma mater, and I'm knowing that if they had tried, they could have raised money, you know. And I guess our dear governor wanted to try to go out with a bang to make his legacy look a little bit better, you know. We came up, raised all kind of money, but that's where it is over there. Now, the beginning of the beginning of the beginning to Holmes County, it started, as far as my thinking, it started from Greenwood, not in Greenwood. We were having voter registration drives and meetings and concerns in Greenwood, Mississippi. And lo and behold, three residents from Holmes County came to one of the mass meetings in Greenwood, and they observed. And then they came back at another time, and they observed. And they said to some of us SNCC workers, says, we would like to get some of y'all to come down to Holmes County. And if y'all come down to Holmes County, we'll be responsible for having a place for you to stay and food, so we can make sure that happens. Those three people was Hartman Turnbull, who is the one that they tried to burn his house down with his family in there and attempted to shoot him as he came out of his house, but he had his automatic rifle, which he generally carries wherever, so when he was coming down the steps, they started shooting at him, he started returning the fire. So that saved him on that. The other two people was Ozell Mitchell and his sister, Alma Cunningham. They came those initial two meetings to Greenwood. So as that turned out, we set up a meeting when some of us would go to Holmes County, which ended up being Bob Moses, Amza Moore, myself, and John Ball. We had a meeting with about 15 or 17 different people from Holmes County to talk about us coming in, and they explained it to us what they could supply and what they'd like for us to do. And that was the beginning of the movement in Holmes County.